Welcome back. Today we're going to talk about a little bit about product design. Not too much detail there since we cover that in actually another class, but more about process selection, what are the process types, how do you determine what those are, and also a little bit on break-even analysis. So let's go ahead and dive in. First of all, into product design and process selection. What does that really mean to us? Well, product design is really the process of defining all of your company's characteristics on what kind of products you can develop. What are things that you can do to be able to manufacture the products that you want? What's the appearance need to look like? What are some of the material requirements? What kind of dimensional requirements or tolerances or do you need? Perhaps you need it to perform a certain way. So for instance, wheels on a car have to perform completely different than wheels on a bus or wheels on a bike. Those are completely different performance standards and those requirements. Also then the type of process when we're looking at different products that we need to make, whether they're technology based or not, really doesn't matter as much as maybe some of the scale and some of the types of things that are available to us on how to look at what types of process to make those products, manufacture those products avail us to. We're going to talk a little more about that in detail. Now, again, this is product based. Talking about services, it's a little bit different. So service design is a little bit unique because there's usually a lot of hands-on effort with employees, customer facing, when you're dealing with services. So you have to have a service defined and also some kind of concepts. What are some of the elements? What are the aesthetics? What are the benefits to your customer? How friendly are you? You know, what kind of customer experience are you giving? Do you have a nice ambiance in your hotel? Let's say that's a very high service industry. So it's a little bit different target when we're talking about this. So most of the processes that we're talking about here is actually building something through a process that you then sell. Whereas a service, the customer is embedded in the process. And so it becomes much more what we call customer experience based. So you still have to target customer needs just like you do in any other design process. However, a service is really where the customer is immersed in it. So for the rest of this talk, we're really going to talk about more product design and the design process for products. So if we kind of think about that, there's usually the ideation, and we talk about this in another course, but I'm not going too much into that. Then we screen ideas. It's like, okay, we have these different ideas, but it really doesn't make sense to pursue anything unless we get some customer feedback and some ideas. Is this a product that people need? Is there a market for it? What's the financial requirements? Can we make it? All those types of things. Any preliminary design and testing. So we'll test prototypes, build them, interact with, again, the customer base or the early adopters. Who wants to buy these? Will they buy them? And so on. Then we finally have a product design. Now notice that the original diagram, there was only one feedback loop from final design. Well, that's the old school way of thinking. Anymore, there's feedback constantly on the way, just like with software where you see, I always tell everybody, every software is a beta because there's always going to be customer feedback that's going to drive the changes in the next sprint. Okay, so one of the questions that we always get is if we're going to make a product, and we're going to spend a certain amount of money, and it costs us so much to make a product, how much of that product do we need to break even? This is what we call the break-even analysis. And it's a very simple idea that you need to recover your costs, at least. You know, what's the minimum? Everybody wants to know that, because then you don't get to profitability or even sustainability until after you've met that break-even point. So there's a couple things we need to understand. First of all is total cost. So total cost is the sum of all of our fixed costs. In other words, those could be one-time costs associated with building a product. Now, typically things like the business general costs are usually not incorporated into that. So you may have a 20% for overhead that includes office space and all these other things. Oftentimes, though, those are not considered in the fixed costs. However, they could be. If you really wanted to understand as a whole of a business of what that cost is, you'd have to break it out into something that you would call a fixed cost. Usually fixed cost, however, is product specific. So let's say, for example, we're going to make a toy train. We need to know all the material costs, motor costs, things that we're going to use to build the train, and what are some things that are a one-time cost for a whole bunch of toy trains we're going to make, and then what things actually change with the number of units, and that's where variable cost comes in. So in other words, maybe we have to invest in some molds that are going to cost us 40 grand for all the trains that we're going to build. However, there's also the variable cost for each train. So maybe it costs $3 in materials that we're going to then build into a train, into each train. So that becomes our variable cost. So those are the two different things that really focus on that cost. Again, usually not overhead. That's usually not considered. So the equation is pretty simple. The total cost is the fixed cost plus the variable cost times the number of units we're going to make, which is Q, quantity. The other thing we want to consider is then, okay, now we're making money on these things. How many units are we going to sell? So, and what's the price per unit or the sales per unit? So really, it's a price per unit times the number of units. So that's a pretty simple calculation. From these two things, we can calculate the break even. How do we do that? Well, let's go to the next step. So typically, if we're going to calculate profit, well, profit is if we take the total revenue of what we've sold minus the total costs. The difference, if it's positive, means we've made a profit. If it's a negative, means we're at a loss. We haven't made a profit. So the break-even then is when that profit is really set to zero, right? Because we haven't made a profit yet, and we haven't lost anything. We've just recovered what we've got. So if we set the total cost equal to the total revenue, and now we plug in those equations that we just had, we can now solve for Q, because Q is on both sides. And if we do that, that Q then becomes QBE, or Q break-even. And this is now the simple equation. So we took the two equations and solved for Q. So Q break-even is equal to the fixed cost divided by the specific price per unit minus the variable cost per unit. So again, that's how we can solve that. So it's a pretty simple equation. It really tells you this is the minimum we have to sell. So in our analyses, we'd have to ask ourselves, is there enough demand to exceed that minimum? And you don't want to just meet the minimum. You want to exceed it so that you make sure that you get beyond that. Because usually, even if the demand's there, you got to make sure, can you target and hit all that demand? A different way to approach this is doing a break-even analysis with graphs. So you have your total cost curve. On this case, it's actually the orange line, and then a total revenue curve, which, you know, with 0 units, you make nothing. So it's always crosses at zero, and then it goes up over a period of time. So the break-even, as we would think, that what we just calculated is really the point where they crisscross. It's the intersection. So it's actually a little bit helpful, though, to plot it. So if we compute the total revenue line, the total fixed variable cost line, plot the two where they crisscross or the intersection, that's our break-even point. So it's another way to look at it. And if you notice anything below, you know, that quantity down here is a loss, which is in this range. And then up here is a gain. So basically, our revenue line's above our cost line. Here, our revenue line's below our cost line. So that really gives you a more intuitive understanding of what it is. Then, if you make this model, you can now play around with lots of things. So we have a break-even example. In this case, it's a movie theater. So let's estimate that each new theater will cost approximately $1 million. Now, that's a low ballpark. If you look at movie theaters around here in Arizona, they're a lot more than that now, more than $1 million. So the theaters will hold 500 people. We'll have 4 showings each day, which is probably low for here, with an average ticket price of $8. Well, it's more than that now. they estimate that the concession sales will be $2 per patron. I should update all these numbers now that I'm looking at them. That's not realistic. The variable costs in labor and material will be estimated to be $6 per patron. So, and that's everything included in. So here, if you notice, they are incorporating some of the overhead by the labor. Now, the material makes sense, but now they're talking about specific labor to the patrons coming in. So somebody has to sell them the tickets. Somebody has to fix and serve any concessions. So how much do they pay for that? So they're actually breaking it down to a variable cost, which is pretty impressive. So if you do that, you get a little bit more accurate measure. And then they're saying they're going to be open 300 days a year, which means they're closed 65 days a year, which sounds like a lot. So what's the average occupancy to break even? So this one's a little bit different because it's instead of a process, we're also looking at capacity. So we may not be using our capacity. In this case, the total revenues equals the total cost of break even, which is what we said before. So we break that down into other prices, selling price times Q, fixed cost plus variable cost times Q. Selling price for tickets, $8, remember, plus $2 for, we're assuming that each person's going to spend about $2 on concessions. Fixed cost is $1 million. Variable cost is $6 per person, because this one, per person, is the Q unit. So if we solve for Q, this means we have to serve about 250,000 patrons. So that's a lot of people. Now, if we look at over 300 days, and that you're going to have four viewings a day, you break that out. If you take that into account, then really we're only talking about 42% occupancy. So if we can sell, you know, just a little bit above 40% of all of our movies, we should be able to break even. So that's not too bad. What's the gross profit if they sell 300,000 tickets? So let's say, okay, instead, we're going to sell, you know, if we want to break it down to the 300, let's say they sell 1,000 tickets a day. That would be quite different, because now then we'd say, okay, now it's Q is equal to 300,000. And if they were to calculate that, their profit would be $200,000. Now, if concessions weren't as popular and they only averaged 50 cents a patron, how does that account for things? So this is something that we can do what we call a sensitivity analysis. We can say, well, let's say on the low end, when they paid 50 cents, on the high end, maybe they paid, like what I have over here, $3.50 per person. So how that can change things. So again, we can modify these things with this model. So that would give us, that would mean to get a break even, we'd actually have to have even more patrons, 400,000 patrons, to get to the same place. So you can do a lot of these different models. And what I suggest, and what I put here, is you want to use a break even analysis spreadsheet. And so I've created a template for you guys. In class, we're going to play around with that spreadsheet so you guys can actually build out your own model, and then you have it so that you can use it. All right. So that's a simple way to do an easy analysis on whether it's worth doing or not. What are some other things, however? Let's get away from the money again. And what are some other things that can affect product design? So when we're designing a product, one of the things we have to keep in mind is the design manufacturable, or is it made to be efficiently manufacturable? Those things matter. We call that in design, and usually in engineering, DFM, or design for manufacturing. And there's some simple guides that you can use to decrease some of those costs, and also to decrease that throughput time. The throughput time is the amount of time it takes something to go through the entire build process. So from the time that all the raw materials get in the door, all the way through the build and assembly process to you have a product out the door. That's your throughput time. Some people actually do it all the way to customer sale. That's a little bit different. That would be a more throughput time, because then you still have inventory costs that go into there. So some of the things you can do are kind of exemplified by this diagram. So if you notice, we have something that has a whole bunch of screws, different pieces, and parts, and requires some assembly. Well, how can we simplify some of that? Well, okay, maybe instead of having these screws go up through the bottom, we have them go through the top. That makes it a little bit easier. Maybe instead of having to insert this in through different holes here, we can have slots here. And now these two pieces are actually just fused onto here where it's melted up, so now we don't have that assembly piece. And, well, maybe that's just even too complicated. Maybe we have something that flexes so that we can put that in. So there's really only some one assembly step. So you notice in this case, reducing the number of assembly steps really can simplify your throughput time and lower your costs. Using a modular design, try to use less or avoid tools, so you see that in a lot of manufacturing. However, sometimes that makes it more difficult for customer maintenance. It depends. So there's pros and cons to that depending upon what type of product you're looking at. But you can simplify your operations a lot. You can also actually make parts for multiple products. So maybe it's something that you can use in multiple places that can give you some standardization across several products. What are some factors in your product lifecycle? Well, you've probably seen this before. For product lifecycle, usually there's introduction, so demand is low. Then you hit a growth curve where demand, actually the rate of demand, is at its peak right around the inflection point and gets up to maturity, and then eventually decline because there's new products that come on cycle and start taking over that product space, or better products. So be aware of this, because when you're looking at wanting to invest in your next product, do you want to be doing it at the time you're at maturity or decline? That's probably too late. Usually when companies will make an investment in the next version of the next thing is somewhere right around the inflection point, ideally, or maybe right after that if they can. So other processes. So in the days of yore, so to speak, engineering used to do things separately from the marketing and from product development and all these kinds of things. In actuality, that's not the case anymore. So here it was, we had concepts from customers, then we created specs, then we had design specs, manufacturing specs, and then they went to production, and then you'd go back again for more information. Well, that turns out to be really slow, and oftentimes there's a lot of miscommunication. It's like the phone game, to where they just don't quite get it down. So the newer design is really to have a design team where you have people from all of these points that all get together and look at things from the manufacturing side of things, from the design engineer, from the marketing perspective, from the consumer perspective. They want to even have that. So you want to have a little bit of all that going on. Other things that can affect our process is remanufacturing. Remanufacturing is a great way to get some benefits out of existing product, and this actually is part of the move to responsible innovation and cycle processing. So let's say you have some old products. It could be that you have a program where you accept some of your old products as trade-ins, and so the customers get a little benefit, or maybe they get a discount on your new product. Well, you can actually take some of the components of that system. Now, this only really works for component-based products or things that are an integrated system. Things like computers, televisions, autos, other types of consumer electronics. It is increasingly starting to get to where you can do it with certain material products, particularly when they choose their materials wisely so that those materials can be recycled and reprocessed in new products. I talk about that a lot more in another class, but in general, with component-based products, it's much easier because you can take those components off of one system and incorporate them in another system without any molding or anything like that, or melting down. Benefits, there's environmental benefits, cost benefits, and more, there's actually good business benefits with goodwill and some customer loyalty who want to see those types of things. So with operations, there's several different types. Some of the things we need to be cognizant of is some of the different operations and why we have them. So one of the big two that people talk about are intermittent operations versus repetitive operations. So an intermittent operation is where we have a variety of products that have different processing requirements. Because of that, and it could be totally that there's no two alike. So that's where healthcare is kind of like every person's kind of unique. Now there's some similarities with people with certain disease states. So they usually have departments for those specific types of disease states. But similarly, for other products where they're very customized, that leads to a real need for intermittent operations. Repetitive operations are things where we don't have nearly as much variety, and we can have some standardizations as for building our products. So to get a better idea, we have this table here that kind of gives us some factors that help. So if product variety is one of our major factors, large variety, that says, well, we should do an intermittent. Small variety, that lends itself to repetitive. And I'll just, instead of going through all these, I'll just hit a couple. Degree of automation with intermittent, usually can't automate as much because there's a variety of things you have to do that are not the same. When you have the same tasks or the same processes, then you can go to a higher degree of automation. Same with standardization that follows the same types of things. And critical resources are different. So intermittent operations, usually there's a lot of labor-intensive components, whereas things that you can automate, it's more capital-intensive. And there's other things as well. So take a look at those. There's four major process types, so you want to know these. There's the project process. This is where we make one product at a time, and this is exactly to customer specifications. So if you ever looked at one of those chopper shows where somebody wants a custom chopper that has XYZ, different certain color, looks a certain way, those are one of a kind, and so they make those. And they sell them for quite a lot because they're custom. That's usually we get custom. Same with like a custom home. You know, this home is designed and built for one person or a couple or whatever. So that's a project process. Different is a batch process. Now, these are types of things that lend themselves to batches. So when you think of like cooking or bread or things that you have certain capacities that you can make so many at a time, and then you have to move it to the next stage. That's what lends itself to a batch process. A lot of chemical engineering is done in a batch process where you have to do one batch, or even in medical device or pharmaceuticals, they make pharma in batches. Line processing is moving a little bit away from that batch processing, where you have a little bit more of a flow through. It's not quite continuous, but you basically have something that goes through one machine and goes into the next machine and the next machine. So line process and batch process tend to have components of each other between them. And then a continuous process is something where for most of the time you can be flowing until there's maintenance that needs to be done, where the input material keeps coming in, there's a process that occurs, maybe it's a filtering process or something, and then outspits the product. Those are more of like a very high volumes, things like oil refineries. However, at some point, they'll need to, again, do some maintenance and things like that before they can go on. So consider this as kind of a continuum. This is kind of the diagram they had in the book for these four types, where standardization goes from high to low. At the top, when you look at project processes, have low standardization all the way to high standardization for continuous. And then, of course, product volume goes from low to high, depending upon where you are. And they have some examples in there. So make sure you can look at those things. So how do we decide? How do we decide which process we want? Well, it kind of depends upon what kind of a process flow do we have, what's our degree of vertical integration that we have, how flexible are our resources, what's our mix of capital and human resources, and what's the degree of customer contact. Now, the way these are presented are really for a product manufacturing company that is already going and already has revenues and profits. Now, if you're a startup, it's a little bit different because you're really working towards your strengths and what resources and skill sets you have, and also some identified product market fit. Those things play a huge role before you can do your selection. So you actually may need to transform from one to another. So you may start in a stage where you're doing small batches of making your product because that's all you have capacity to do. Once you get a little more money and you get a little more room to breathe, now you got a little more runway. Now you can invest in trying to semi-automate some processes or maybe automate some processes. because your demand's growing now. So as your demand grows, you can start building out more advanced processes. So it's not just a cut and dry, I want to select this process or that process, when you're still building your capital, because you might not have the capital at the get-go to build out everything, unless you're an extremely well-funded startup that has lots of dollars to be able to do that. And you may. That's a possibility too. But I want that to be understood, that that's part of that as well. Process design tools. You can have simple processes that are in series. So when we look at a process, these are simple flow diagrams. So a multi-stage process really says that, well, we have some input materials. It has to go through stage one, then it has to go through stage two, then it has to go through stage three. And then when it's done, the product's on the output of stage three. There's also could be a multi-stage process that has some buffers where we have some work in process inventory. And as we'll learn later, when we get to JIT, we'll talk more about how we want to minimize that. Something that's more advanced could be where you have parallel processes. So maybe you have two different types of things going into two different stages. And it could be the same material, but because stage one processes it in one way, you get a different product. Product one versus stage two gives you a different type of product, product two. And again, this could be in a stage. It doesn't have to be your final product. There's also parallel stages that come together. So maybe you have something where you make one part with stage one, another part with stage two, then they have to be assembled and you get a finished good. So that's the same. That's a different type of flow. Okay, so we want to design the process. Well, we kind of have to understand the flow. This is called a process flow analysis. Now, the easiest way to do this is usually to visualize. And to visualize, we might like to make flow charts. And when we make flow charts, we want to consider different type of things. Do we want a make-to-stock strategy? Do we want an assemble-to-order strategy? Or maybe a make-to-order strategy? Those different types of things lend us to different styles of flowcharts. So let's take a look at an example of a pizzeria, something easy to understand. A make-to-stock strategy says, okay, we have a list of ingredients. We're going to make the dough, prepare some crust, assemble pizza, bake it, and then we'll have stocked some good pizza, some inventory. So that way, when the customer comes in, all they have to do is look at our inventory and say, I want pizza X. And boom, there it is. That's what they get. An assemble to order strategy, really what we're doing here is we're moving the inventory in a different spot. So here we got dough, crust, and then so we have an inventory of just crust. So we're not doing the assembly or the baking yet. We keep our crust there so the crust is ready, and now when the customer orders, we can do a made-to-order. So we'll assemble the pizza and bake it there on demand. That's a bit like what Mod Pizza does, if you've ever been there. Made-to-order strategy means, all right, we're not going to do anything until we get a customer order. We don't want to even have that investment. So we're going to make the dough, then we're going to prepare the crust, assemble the pizza, blah, 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 once the customer's ordered. So now that's probably going to take us a longer period of time than the others. So what you've seen in a lot of things is trying to move and shorten the time that the customer has to wait. So if we look at this, this is where we're trying to reduce throughput time. So if the customer has a long wait, that could really cost a problem. So this is kind of a process flow chart from the customer's perspective. So if they have a long wait, then they have to keep waiting. We may lose a sale. They may get upset and leave. Or sometimes they keep waiting and then they place an order. They're waiting for an order again. It could be a long wait. So that could be a problem area. Or maybe we get the order incorrect. That could be a problem area. So you see, when we look at these processes as we design them and build them with some decision triangles, then we can kind of look at, okay, which processes do we want to modify or optimize? And we can do that. Ways that we can figure out how to optimize these not just reducing throughput time, is also looking at other measurements. So different performance metrics other than throughput time are also something we want to look at. So throughput time, again, is the average time to go from raw materials all the way through product. So for our pizza, it was to go from dough to customer pizza. Now, that could be that throughput time could be measured from the time the customer orders to the time they get the pizza, which for the customer is actually something they probably want. They want their pizza quick. Process velocity is different. It's a measure of the time that's wasted in the system. So it's your throughput time, which is the one above, divided by the value added time. So how much time is it sitting there doing nothing versus the amount of time that's adding value to the system. So if you think of like a doctor's office, maybe you had to wait in your doctor's office for an hour and you only saw your doctor for 15 minutes. So if your throughput time was 1 hour and the only time you got to see him, the value added time was 15 minutes, that doesn't sound like very good process velocity. Now you want to target to a value of 1. That means every ounce of time is value added time. So that's kind of the best you can get. Productivity, we've talked about that before. It's the output over input, depending upon how we measure that. So for example, we could build 10 widgets per labor hour. Utilization is resource-based. So how well are we using a resource? So the time that the resource is used divided by the time the resource is available. So if that resource is available 24 hours a day and we're only using it 8 hours a day, well, okay, that gives us a fraction, just about a third of what would be there. So in this example, I've got a machine A utilization of 60%. So it's being used about 60% of the available time. So maybe that's two shifts out of a 24-hour shift, two 8-hour shifts. And that's pretty common. So sometimes they'll just add another night shift to maximize that machine use. Other things are efficiency, so like actual output divided by standard output. Now this is usually only established once you've developed what a standard output should be or could be. That could be based upon a person, that could be based upon what a machine can normally do, and what's the actual. So we're measuring to what where we think that standard is. So it's a different version of efficiency. Okay, so we also want to link product design and process selection. So they're directly linked. The type of product selected defines the operation required. Again, if we're making a 747, that's going to be more like a project. And it's going to be a little bit custom made, custom order based upon the airline that's ordering it. That's going to be quite different than if you're trying to make a rubber toy that you have in molds. So the type of operation available defines broader organization. So the equipment that's required, what type of facility arrangement is required, and how do we have to have an organizational structure to support that. So we can look at different decisions. So if we're going to do product design, maybe it's early stage of product life for intermittent operations. So that's kind of like in the startup world, like I was talking about. Later stage of life, we might be able to get more repetitive operations. So we can bring that cost for a product down. Competitive priorities, if we want more flexibility, quality, deliverability, maybe intermittent is the way to go. If we're trying to minimize costs and or have processes that are the same every time to control quality, maybe that's something that we do repetitive. And so on. So there's a lot of these things. Our vertical integration, is it low or high? Depends upon that too. So those are the two I talked about there. Okay. There's different types of layouts for these types of things. So intermittent. So let's take, for example, like hospitals or something like that. That might be laid out differently than a repetitive facility layout. So intermittent layout could be you have different departments. Now you might want departments that where something goes from, say, like Department A to Department E, and then to Department C, you probably want those closely located. And you don't want things that have to go between Department A and Department F, the way you have this laid out. We'll talk more about that later. Versus something that's repetitive, you'll see things like in series and in parallels, like some of those processes that we saw before. So another example, then, is like the made-to-stock here. So we've got inventory. So here we're minimizing delivery time. It's the same thing with the pizza. Whereas assemble to order, now we're giving a little bit more flexibility, but then that also requires some assembly time. Or a total made to order, maybe that requires more than just assembly. Maybe there are certain parts that need to be created before assembly and then shipping. So all those things matter. Oh, yeah. So that's what you're saying is, where I'm outlining is, where you notice the delivery time is directly related to where we're keeping that inventory. Our degree of vertical integration and whether or not we're going to make or buy something. Our vertical integration refers to how much do we control from raw materials all the way to sales. So if we do backward integration, that means we're going up to the primary operations, meaning all the way closer to raw materials, that we're controlling that versus contracting out to somebody else. Forward integration, meaning that we're controlling more of what happens closer to customers. Maybe instead of using a distributor, we go direct sales. That's kind of what that means. So an example of a company that's gone in both directions is Tesla, you know, where they're controlling their battery manufacturing, even to the point where they're going to be next to railroads to get the lithium for their batteries. That's up in Northern Nevada. All the way down to controlling with the customers. So they even eliminated the car dealership where they're doing a direct to customer. Make or buy choices are things that you have to look at depending upon where you are. Is it more cost effective for you to make something or buy something? We're going to talk about this in chapter 4, so I'm not going to go into it too much here. Now, we always incorporate technology. This, of course, completely affects our process. Do we incorporate information technology? Now we have what we call enterprise resource planning, big data. Do we have ways to look at the data that we're using so that we can share our demands with our suppliers or understand what our customers are doing with our products or what they're buying? GPS and LPS data. So that's global positioning and local positioning systems. How are we utilizing that? Maybe we're utilizing the phone networks to see where our customers are because we have software that does that. Or maybe we're using RFIDs so that we can locate where products are in a retail center. We might be doing that. Automation, that's another area where we're heavily looking at. Using machinery to perform work without human operators or maybe in concert with human operators. So those things like robotics, automated material handling, automated storage and retrieval systems. So this is oftentimes for data. Even for warehouse systems, so that's something that Amazon uses quite a lot. Numerically controlled equipment, that's a little less on the forefront. Flexible manufacturing systems, again, these are all different types of things that are going on, and you can look into any one of these. Okay, also e-design and manufacturing, so there's a lot more web-based tools to create opportunities. So maybe your customer gets to design something on the web where they say, hey, I want to have that. Or maybe you're collaborating with somebody else. You have your designers in one country and you have your fabricators in another country and then you're assembling in your country. That's very common. Computer-aided design, where we can use computer graphics to make things. Computer-integrated manufacturing. Now, this is part of that automation we've talked about. And 3D printing, which is kind of one of the ultimate computer-integrated manufacturing, where you're actually printing out 3D components and parts. How are designing services a little bit different on this? We're usually producing intangible products. However, sometimes it's service combined with products. It involves a high degree of customer contact, and the service type is classified according to the degree of customer contact. So really the levels go from all the way from pure services to things like restaurants, which even aren't, I wouldn't say pure anymore, healthcare facilities, schools, hospitals, down to mixed services, which some of those probably now are mixed, like offices and banks, insurance, down to quasi-manufacturing, where they're more like warehouses, back office facilities, and things like that. So you can see the difference of degree of labor intensity for these different types of things. The service value proposition is different on physical goods, the essential benefits of what the customer is looking for, What are the psychological benefits? So they really need to have that experience for service value. Different from innovating components, where you're substituting technology for people, getting customer involved, getting high customer attention. All right, so that's mostly it. The last slide really just talks about who you need to coordinate with any of these things. Marketing needs to be involved, finance needs to be involved, information services, human resources, purchasing, and engineering. They all need to understand how we're going to design these processes, because all of these groups would be involved. And so when you're in a larger corporation and you have all these types of departments, oftentimes you want these people at the table, or they're representing these functions at the table, so you can help design and develop these processes. That's all for today. Thank you so much, and I'll see you in class.